one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. There are places in the wilderness of North Carolina where the forest is so thick that if you step off the trail, you may never find it again. If you venture off to get a good view or to take a look at some wildlife, it's really difficult to find the trail. You can pass back over it and end up deeper into the wilderness. So backpackers do something called drop the pack, where they drop their backpack literally in the middle of the trail. So that way when they're headed back to the path, they have a sign, a symbol, that can orient them correctly. They know which way to go when they've dropped their pack on the trail. When you're lost in the woods, you actually aren't really lost. You don't know where the trail is. You know exactly where you are, but it's the way forward that's unclear. The second letter of Peter is written to a community that's unsure of the way forward. The church thought that Jesus was going to come back any day now, and more time that has passed, they have started to become unsure of the way forward. You can imagine the church meeting perhaps in the living room of someone's house, and the oldest people of the community, they would have heard directly from the apostles themselves. But as more and more time has passed, that generation is dying away. As the community looks around, they see fewer and fewer of those faces. And they have to be wondering, is the hope of Christ dying too? The second letter of Peter is written to a community about the faithfulness of God to answer this question of what happens when it seems like God has abandoned us. Now this community, false teachers propped up in their midst. The text calls them scoffers all the way through. I imagine these scoffers maybe got their start at the equivalent of coffee hour, whispering to one another, "Psst, are you sure that God is really coming back? Perhaps we've been abandoned." And they say, if God has abandoned us, maybe we can abandon God's vision for the world. These scoffers say, we should live our lives the way we want. We can orient them around our own desires. The author of 2 Peter is writing to assure the community of God's faithfulness. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I can relate to these scoffers. Sometimes I turn on the news and I wonder, has God abandoned the world? I listen to whatever headline of the particular day and think perhaps the only solution to this trouble we're in is divine intervention. Sometimes in the sense of this abandonment that we may feel, some people cling to despair and cynicism. They say, it appears that God has abandoned the world, and so I might as well abandon God's vision for the world too. Let the poor get poorer, the sick get sicker, the lonely get lonelier. That's one way of living in this sense of abandonment, of being unsure of the way forward. Another group can sometimes act like a hamster on the hamster wheel, where we think, it's okay if we're all alone. As long as I try hard enough and work hard enough, my salvation can be in my own hands. My reorientation is up to me. In a sense of abandonment and being unsure about God's presence, both of these responses make sense. They're natural. When things are uncertain, we want to cling to something secure. But each one of these paths is a lie, and they lead to our own destruction. They get us lost in the woods. Maybe you've been lost in the woods before, literally. Maybe you've been lost in the woods before spiritually. Perhaps unsure of the way forward after an unexpected event, a broken relationship, a sudden death. When you're lost in the woods and you realize the trail is gone, that sense of panic rises in your chest and you thrash around wildly trying to figure out what way to go. I know what this is like because I've been there. I've been lost in the woods in more ways than one. In fact, one time I even got an entire group of people lost in the woods as a backpacking leader. I was leading a trip through Mount Mitchell State Park, and as we pulled up to the parking lot, we got out of the car, put on our backpacks, and set off for the trail. Now, about 4 hours later, we still had not found the trail. We had wandered up and down the mountainside, climbing over branches and logs and pushing through brambles, trying to find the way forward. I turned the map every which way, sure that there was some orientation of the map that could get us in the right spot. After 4 hours, though, I finally admitted defeat and embarrassed went back down to the car because we hadn't made it very far, so we were still near the parking lot. Now, you know the story turns out okay because I'm standing before you today, but it can be hard to know what to do when you're lost and disoriented. The second letter of Peter has some good news on this front. The author says, God has not abandoned the world, God has reoriented the world. Things are not as they seem, he says. Now, this message can be a little bit hard to hear because there's a lot of images of fire and destruction in the text. This is the genre, the apocalyptic literature, that happens so much in Advent. We also see it in Revelation. There are places where these images of fire and destruction are communicating something. The genre is like if David Letterman were writing a book of the Bible, it would be a top 10 list. A second century Jewish writer, if they're trying to make a point, they're probably going to use apocalyptic literature. And this genre communicates something important. It communicates that the stakes are real. Our world is finite, and God is infinite. And God's infinite power will ultimately have authority over the finite world. That's what the genre communicates. Within this specific text, what's being said is that how we understand the world is not the same as how God understands the world. The author of 2 Peter says what looks like slowness is actually patience. God is not being slow, has not abandoned you, but is waiting for all people to come to salvation. God has reoriented the world, and our understanding of time is not the same as God's understanding of time. What the author of 2 Peter is inviting us to do is to let go of our small map of the world, the one where everything makes sense, and instead hold on to God's cosmic map that reorients our lives and points us in a different direction. This map says that what looks like slowness is patience. What looks like abandonment is mercy. What looks like ethical chaos is actually a call to righteousness. This is an unexpected path, but we recognize this unexpected God. This is the God who sends a tiny baby to save the world when everyone was expecting a mighty king. The God who offers us eternal life, but first it leads through death on the cross. This is our unexpected God who reorients the world and offers us a new map. If we use our old map, we are going to get lost in the woods. And this is exactly what happened with that backpacking trip that I was leading. If you'll remember, after 4 hours of wandering through the wilderness, we were back at the car and filling up our water bottles. And a member of the group pointed across the parking lot and she said, "What's that over there?" And we all got a little closer and realized it was a huge, wide as a barn door, couldn't miss it, entrance to the trail. It was mulched, there were reflective signs, everything was very well labeled. But I completely missed it because I was using an old map. I was more focused on the piece of paper in front of me than lifting my eyes and realizing that the entrance to the trail had moved. There is a path that is laid before us. God has laid a path peace, of mercy, of righteousness. In Advent, we often talk about reorientation and reorienting our lives. It's a season of checking the map, making sure that we are on God's path. Something backpackers use to help them find their way is something called a handrail. And a handrail is a geographical feature, perhaps a mountain range or a valley or a river. And this is a feature that you can identify and say, okay, the path stays on the west side of this mountain ridge. If I cross over the mountain ridge, I'm off the path. I'm going to get disoriented. In our spiritual lives, we have handrails too. I encourage you this week to think about what's one of your handrails for your journey through this world. Perhaps it's spending time in prayer with God. Perhaps it's reading scripture. Perhaps it's serving the most vulnerable of our society. Perhaps it's coming to this table and receiving the body of Christ broken for you. We all have practices that we can use as handrails to help keep us oriented on the path that God desires for us. Not the path of this world, but the path of God's world. God has reoriented the world, and God has reoriented our lives. This Advent, let's check the map and make sure we are on the wide path of peace and mercy.